Ladies and gentlemen, Lynne Fernandez is here. She's with the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives. Lynne has an MA in economics from the University of Manitoba and is a research associate at the Manitoba office for the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives. Lynne has had the opportunity to research both municipal and provincial social and economic policy. She's also interested in labour and in environmental issues. Lynne is an expat Albertan who was born and raised in Calgary. And it says here she likes living in Winnipeg. I would attest she loves living in Winnipeg. Here's Lynne.
Thank you very much, Richard, and thank you very much, Louis, for your blessings this evening. I hope they have the intended effect. And everybody, this is take a deep breath because we're going to talk about a little bit of economic stuff. And if you could advance, please. Thanks. Tonight I want to look a little bit at what the industry claims are around the economic issues because of course the whole rationale for going ahead with the tar sands and for this particular project are economic and the economic benefits not just to Alberta but to Canada as a whole. And then I want to take a look at an independent evaluation of the Northern Gateway Pipeline proposal, and so we can get a contrast of what the industry says and what somebody who's perhaps a little more arm's length would say, please. This first slide is showing you information from the Canadian Energy Research Institute, which claims to be a research institute that is impartial and objective and has on its board people from federal and provincial government, from academia, which seems to be one guy from the University of Calgary, and of course members from the oil and gas industry, particularly Imperial Oil and Nexon. So I do question really how objective it is. But this organization does economic research, and it looked at three case scenarios, and I'm showing you the third one, which is looking at the economic impact of existing pipelines and adding on top of that the Trans-Canada Keystone XL pipeline, which we've heard so much about from the States, and then the Northern Gateway pipeline. And according to this institute, these three case scenarios combined together, over the 2010 and 2020 period, they have an estimated investments and reinvestments and revenues from operation of oil, what they call oil sands, we call tar sands, which will add up to over $1 trillion in that 10-year period. So that's $100 billion, more than that, and that's actually getting close to the amount of Canadian GDP. And they also claim that the investment shocks, what they call investment shocks, to Canadian GDP, once again will be over $1 trillion in this 10-year period. Employee compensation, $342 billion. They claim that jobs by 2020 will go up to 800,000 in Canada. And Alberta royalties paid by the oil industry to Alberta will go from $3.56 billion to $26 billion by 2020. And the other thing that I think is really interesting, if you look at the last three points, this report also shows what the economic impact is going to be for the United States. It's something I didn't really expect to see from a Canadian website. I mean, really, is it that significant? Well, it turns out that it is. And as you can see, for example, there's $138 billion worth of economic impact in the United States. And U.S. employment will go from 80,000 jobs to 200,000 jobs by 2020. So this contention that we've been hearing that actually the tar sands and the oil industry in Alberta does more, just almost as much to export jobs and stimulate economies in a foreign country is actually true, even by the industry's own admission. It's also important to point out that according to the analysis that I'm going to get to in a moment, the estimated investment and reinvestment generated by this particular project, by the Northern Gateway project, do not represent, I repeat, an increase in the productive capacity of the Canadian economy. This project will simply redirect existing supply. It's not going to actually increase production. So I'm going to turn to this report that just came out. It was done by a BC economist named Robin Allen, and she presented this support to the National Energy Board Joint Review Panel as evidence. And they tried not to let her present it, actually. They tried, she put her name down to present, and they wouldn't let her. But she managed to present because the Alberta Federation of Labour had a spot to present, so they let her present on their behalf. And I'm going to hit some of the highlights of her report. I know I have a very short period of time. It's a very in-depth, complicated report, and there's just no way I can do it justice. But do keep in mind that she's very critical of the simple assumptions that are made about price, economic conditions, and exchange rates. And the report that she's critiquing was done by Enbridge, but it was done by some consultants that Enbridge hired to do an economic analysis for them. So they really chose a lot of best case scenario assumptions throughout their analysis, and she's quite critical of that. Please. So the claims made by Enbridge are that between 2013 and 2046, the report that Enbridge uses concludes that the project will create GDP growth of $270 billion and labor income of $48 billion. And that there will be government revenues of $81 billion. So this is something that the industry is very careful to highlight all the time: how much tax that they're going to be paying, and how much revenue is going to be going into government coffers, not just provincial but also federal. And Robin Allen is very critical, because the report really looks at what all the economic additions are going to be, what the benefits are going to be, but it doesn't take into consideration any externalities. And externalities, of course, as most of you will know, will be the cost to the environment, the social costs, the costs that society has to bear but that the industry is not going to be responsible for. And if you're going to do a fair economic analysis, of course, you have to consider what these externalities are. If you look at that red part there, she claims that Enbridge is allowed to use the economic gains from potential, and potential, it has to be emphasized, future production to make its public interest case to the Joint Review Panel, while the environmental costs that arise from this same projected production are explicitly excluded from being brought to bear on the discussion. So even without the externalities, and what Robin Allen did is says, okay, fine, let's not talk about externalities. You guys are talking about what an economic boon this is going to be. I'm going to evaluate your assessment strictly on economic terms. I'm just going to do a straight up neoclassical analysis here. I'm not going to take into effect the cost of the environment or the social costs. And even when she did that sort of an evaluation, she found that the Northern Gateway Pipeline will create little, if any, real benefit, and is more likely to have long-term negative economic consequences. Underlying assumptions. This is sort of the Achilles heel of economic modeling, because these models that they do, they have to make certain assumptions that they often are holding constant, and your analysis only ends up being as good as the assumptions that you're making. Allen refers to the assumption made in Enbridge's analysis of the exchange rate, for example, over time as being faulty. They assume an 85-cent Canadian dollar, and you know, over the last 3 years or 2 years, we certainly have seen that that's not the case. And she says it could just as easily be a 95-cent Canadian dollar, or even at par. And as soon as you make that sort of a change, it kind of blows their projections out of the water. And she says it could represent actually an economic cost to the Canadian oil and gas industry. Her overall conclusion is that the Northern Gateway threatens the long-term stability of the Canadian economy and negatively impacts the standard of living for most Canadians. And she says, even emphasizing that excluding the broader environmental concerns of a full accounting framework, the Northern Gateway project is just not in the public interest of Canada. So let's look at some of the reasons that she says this. There's a bit of an overview of the problems that she feels are not dealt with in Enbridge's analysis. The first one is price increases. We will have to pay $2 to $3 more per barrel of crude oil for the next 30 years. And she claims, and I think we'll see that she's probably right, that this price increase is solely attributable to the new pipeline. In fact, Allen claims that the purpose, the actual purpose of the Northern Gateway Pipeline project is to increase the price of crude oil for all Canadian consumers. And this is significant, as I'll explain. This is how the price increase works. Right now, there's already an excess of crude oil production coming out of Western Canada. It's kind of bizarre because we're exporting so much of it down to the States when Eastern Canada has to import foreign oil, but that's another issue. Most of a lot of the oil is being exported to the U.S. Midwest, and that's causing a glut of crude oil. And as we know, when there's an excess supply, the price is going to come down. So it lowers the price on the benchmark West Texas Intermediate, which is the price sort of pricing mechanism for crude in North America. Canadian producers, of course, don't necessarily like low prices. If they can get higher prices, they'll definitely go for it. So they sort of scan the global economy and they say, is there anybody out there who would actually pay more for our crude? And if so, we'll restrict how much is sold in Canada, and we'll restrict how much is exported to the U.S., and we'll sell where the supply is lower and the demand is greater. So, of course, when they do this scan to see where this market might be, it turns out that it's in Northeast Asia. And they're on a different pricing mechanism, they're in a different market, and so Northeastern prices are set differently, and they pay what's called an Asian premium on their crude. So the Northern Gateway, they hope, will piggyback on this premium, and that's why they're looking to get that oil into BC so they can get it into the Northeast Asian market. And this is a quote from her report, that Canadians will find themselves pushed into an international demand curve that accepts higher prices, and higher prices that then we as Canadians will have to deal with. There's some debate about whether this Asian premium actually exists, and whether it will continue, especially if Canada starts providing oil to China, and they might actually sort of ruin that Asian premium as China's options for buying oil sort of expand. The ability to discriminate based on pricing will deteriorate, and there's actually a good chance that this price premium will disappear once Canada starts exporting to China. So if Enbridge can't capture this higher price for its crude oil, there will actually be no net benefit to the oil and gas sector, and there will be no economic case for going ahead with Northern Gateway. But what's important to remember is that without an inflationary increase in oil prices, Enbridge's claims as to the benefits of the project disappear. Nonetheless, Enbridge is proceeding as if this price premium is real and will last. If this is a quote from this president of Liquid Pipelines for Enbridge, and as you can see, he says that the victim is price. And that is what the Northern Gateway Pipeline is all about. It's not about whether you can move the barrels to the U.S., but the price punishment that takes place when you have no other market available. So Enbridge is admitting that the reason for going ahead with the Northern Gateway project is so that they can have access to this different market. And the dynamics of the oil market mean that those higher prices will be passed on to Canadians. Assuming that Enbridge's analysis is correct, and Robin Allen is not so sure that it is, but even assuming that it is, and they're able to capture this higher price premium, inflation will follow. And although a list of nasty things follows when you have inflation, and there'll be a decrease in purchasing power, which is something that's been decreasing over the last 30 or 40 years anyway, we'll see a decline in real GDP, decline in government revenues, et cetera, et cetera. The other thing that happens, likely will happen, will be there'll be an appreciation of the Canadian dollar. And that leads to a thing called Dutch disease, and the definition of which is a decline in exports of manufacturing goods caused by a resource export boom. And the export boom causes an appreciation of domestic currency because there's more and more domestic currency coming into Canada to purchase our oil. That leads to inflation and lower levels of income growth and rising unemployment in the non-resource sector. So it's the influx of foreign exchange that causes Dutch disease, and it can have a devastating effect on the economy, as it did in Holland with North Sea oil, which is where this phenomenon was first identified. This graph is from Ellen's report, and there is a debate about whether we have Dutch disease in Canada, if the high Canadian dollar is indeed caused by the oil industry. But we do see here in this graph a definite correlation between the price of oil and the exchange rate. And I also think that if it were just caused by the devaluation of the American dollar because of the recession, because our economy is so tied to the American economy, why is our Canadian dollar not being brought down with the American dollar? Because people perceive our economy as being so tied to it. So I think there is something going on here that's keeping our dollar high, other than the fact that we came through the recession better than they did. Once again, from Ellen's report to the National Energy Board, this development of a natural resource like this that leads to Dutch disease, which affects the entire country and causes our manufacturing sector to be less productive, leads to regional disparities. The fact that a rapidly appreciated dollar dramatically reduces the breadth and resiliency of the business sector makes our economy dependent on high commodity prices and exacerbates regional disparities. There's another report from Desjardins in 2006 that talks about the sort of vagaries of Dutch disease and questions the wisdom of exploiting the tar sands. And at the bottom there, you can see that they are concerned that deep down there are regional and sectoral disparities which occur from having a high Canadian dollar. What happens is that kind of takes us back to being drawers of water and hewers of wood, which has always been a criticism of the Canadian economy, that we don't have a sophisticated manufacturing sector. And the Northern Gateway Pipeline will ensure that the Canadian economy moves further away from a diversified manufacturing sort of economy, and we remain keep that more sort of primitive drawer of resources that doesn't that create forward and backward linkages and create high quality jobs. Just quickly, I wanted to take a look at how important the oil and gas sector is in the Canadian economy, because it seems to be such an important force, and it certainly is in Alberta. It's the main driver in Alberta. But it's actually 11th down here. I don't know if you can read that, but it's 11th down here in terms of percentage of GDP by sector. And that's even combining it with the mining sector as well. So by far, the most important sector is the finance and real estate, etc., and then after that is manufacturing. So when you put that in perspective, you can see it really carries a lot of weight in terms of policy, etc., but it's not really that important in the Canadian economy overall. Nonetheless, it gets a lot of tax incentives, something that the report doesn't talk about, and certainly something that people in Alberta don't talk about very much, is how much money they actually get in subsidies from governments. According to these two reports, it's up to almost $2 billion a year in subsidies. So they don't just pay into revenues, they get money back. You've probably all heard the old argument that the West wants in. This is something that came out of Alberta, complaining about it having such economic clout, but not having political clout in Canada. I would argue that the oil and gas sector is giving Alberta a lot of political power that is growing, and that its free market ideology is shaping policy on the national stage. For example, look at Harper's strong support of resource extraction as an economic strategy or nation building. The next slide will show you that Alberta's revenue, 28% of its revenue comes from the oil and gas industry, and then they use beggar thy neighbor policies for the rest of Canada, telling us that we have to keep our taxes down in order to be competitive with them. The problem is that a province like Manitoba can't get 28% of its revenues from oil and gas, and so it really does create a lot of political and economic disparity right even here in Western Canada as well. What happens because of the power that the oil industry has is that we have no strategic oil reserves in Canada. We are the only country in the 27-member International Energy Agency without a national strategy for security, energy security. And Canada is actually the most energy insecure member of that organization. And we have to remember that U.S. corporations control up to half of Alberta's oil. NAFTA, you probably have all heard of the proportionality clause. We cannot even limit exports, even in the case of a national emergency. We have to continue exporting proportionately the same amount to the United States as we produce ourselves. That's enshrined in NAFTA, and we can't change that. We have to continue exporting to the United States. So where does that leave us? The oil and gas sector, I would argue, distorts the importance of Alberta. The oil and gas sector puts our economy at risk rather than giving us security. It creates regional disparities. It doesn't allow us to nation build at all. It's actually sort of destroying the nation. And it puts our energy security at risk. And finally, if we carry that into the tar sands, as the largest hydrocarbon reserve in the world, Alberta will continue wreaking havoc with pan-Canadian policy and economy. It will continue shipping value-added economic activity and jobs out of Canada. And the Chinese want a piece of the action. The Americans are going to want to protect their interests. So that's an interesting dynamic. I don't even know how to begin thinking about that. And I contend that what should actually be a national treasure is going to turn out to be a national curse. So, that's it. Thank you very much.